We all know that single-cell profiling is immensely powerful for clarifying the structure of a cell population. And typically, this exercise comes in at least two flavors. So we can resolve discrete cell types by clustering. I'm going to look at the bottom. And also, what I'll talk about today is resolving more dynamic processes, so assembling a series of single-cell snapshots as cells are asynchronously performing some task, and seeing if we can reconstruct a picture for how this process is happening. So perhaps one of the most profound cell state changes in biology is embryonic development. So illustrated here for the zebrafish, the process starts with a single cell, the fertilized egg, and ultimately gives rise to an entire adult body. So we're using zebrafish for this work, mainly because they're a great model for vertebrate development. They're accessible, we can get large numbers of the animals. They develop externally, and you can literally watch in transparent tissues the process happening. So in this rapidly sped up movie, you can see that over about 3 days, you go from a single cell to a fish, has all of its internal organs, it has a beating heart, and eventually the ability to swim away. So this process is just so immensely complex. We've been studying it for decades, but we still have such a long way to go. And historically, developmental biologists have used a number of approaches to look at development. So probably the classic approach is the genetic approach, both forward and reverse. We study gene by gene, functionally, to see what are the important regulators of the process. Also a mainstay, especially in the zebrafish community, is fate mapping. So labeling a cell and coming back later and seeing what that cell made. So together, these two have been kind of the workhorses of developmental biology. And what we'd like to kind of put forward is that with single cell analysis, especially deep sequencing with large numbers of cells, really might give us a totally new approach for looking at developmental biology. So kind of looking back at the classic Waddington landscape model for development, we can imagine cells in a developing embryo become increasingly canalized into discrete cell states. And the task then is if we can densely sample all of the cell states as cells are navigating down this landscape, we may be able to reconstruct this process. So there's sort of two features to this framework. One is the landscape that kind of forces cells into these different canals or these different canalized fates, and also the path that cells take through this landscape. So the path or the set of paths that's accessible to the cells looks a lot like a tree. So what I'll tell you today is our efforts, and we're still kind of at the beginning of this effort, to try to take whole embryo single cell data and use it to reconstruct trees of development. So the outline for today, I'll start by introducing the platform we're using in the Klein Lab. So this is the InDrops platform. And then I'll talk about the tools we're building and the kind of methodologies that we're thinking of for mapping differentiation hierarchies. So it's hard to believe that it was only last year that the droplet methods were first published. So before 2015, profiling thousands or especially tens of thousands of cells was simply prohibitively expensive. So there's a whole class of questions that was really inaccessible to the single cell technology until I think these methods and maybe some other very high throughput methods came along. So I'll tell you a little bit more about the method that we use in our lab, the Klein Lab. So this method we call InDrops for indexing single cells inside droplets. And it's a microfluidic method that relies on the encapsulation of individual cells into nanoliter-sized droplets. So we're co-encapsulating these cells along with a synthetic hydrogel. This hydrogel carries with it a primer for reverse transcription, and that primer has all kinds of goodies in it. It has cell barcodes, it has UMIs, all the molecular tags we need to deconvolute the sample later on. So after encapsulation, we perform our RT reaction inside the droplets, where we barcode each cell's entire transcriptome using this system. We can then break the droplets and perform a kind of more or less standard next generation sequencing library prep. This is a schematic of the InDrops device. It's a PDMS-based microfluidic flow device with 1, 2, 3, 4 inlet chambers and a single output chamber where we harvest our droplets. So this is a zoom of the fluidic junction in the device. And basically the way it works is we have three reagents that we want to mix together inside the droplets. We have a suspension of single cells. We have our RT mix that has enzyme, RT enzyme, and detergent. And then we have these barcoded hydrospheres. So a lot of care went into the design of this device to allow a very kind of unique feature, which is this very regular hydrodynamic release of these barcoded gels into the droplet stream. So this is probably the greatest strength of the InDrops platform in that, as you can see, almost every single droplet that gets formed has one of these gels inside of it. What that means is that every cell or nearly every cell that enters the device can actually be captured. So we have a very high capture rate for this method. Now, given that this is a workshop, I wanted to kind of just summarize some of the statistics of the InDrops method and maybe for comparison, show some of some relevant stats for some of the other droplet methods that are out there. So as I said, the two kind of open source methods that we have access to are InDrops and DropSeq, developed by Evan McCasco. Now, as I said before, one of the features of InDrops that we're really proud of is the high capture efficiency due to the gel occupancy in our droplets. Another feature of InDrops is that we typically do experiments with, we do our runs under real-time monitoring. So we have a high-speed camera that's focused then on the fluidic junctions, and this allows us to adjust flow rates and kind of monitor the droplet stream as it's happening. The time to capture about 10,000 cells, for us, it tends to be half an hour to 60 minutes. And at that, the flow rates required to get this, we have a doublet rate of about maybe 5% or so. So again, we think these are some of the features. Again, yes, some of the other distinguishing features are we're performing our RT within the droplets. DropSeq performs it outside of the droplets after breaking the emulsion. For those that care, we actually use a different cDNA amplification chemistry for InDrops than the other two methods. We use a CellSeq, which is a linear-based amplification, rather than the exponential PCR-based. And this is sort of my subjective kind of assessment of what I think are the strengths and weaknesses of each method. So I think InDrops really shines at its cell capture and cost-effective, similar to DropSeq. Both are much more affordable than the commercial alternative that most people use now. 10x Genomics, however, has probably it's the easiest thing to run from what I've heard. I haven't run it myself, but it sounds like it takes 10 minutes. Everything is very streamlined and very easy. The weaknesses, though, for the 10x, obviously cost is a major downside. The weaknesses for InDrops probably are the difficulty in actually doing the run. So you'll actually hear from Sarah later today about the single cell core that our lab has established in the SysBio department. And so our kind of way to address this is to create a core facility where we have experts trained on the device and you bring your sample in and you're kind of taking advantage of all that experience to get high quality samples. Okay. So one other thing is there's been a recent paper, I think this is in press now, so be on the lookout. This is a kind of an update to the InDrops library prep procedure. This Nature Protocols paper also has very detailed, much more detailed than was in the original paper for how, if you wanted to set up your own device and sort of how to make the hydrogels and do all those things. There's also a GitHub for the bioinformatics pipeline for the low-level processing of the raw sequencing data. That's also been updated recently. Okay, so that was kind of an intro to the platform that we're using. I'll talk a little bit about how we're using that to try to map differentiation hierarchies. And again, we're doing this in many different flavors in the Klein Lab. My particular interest is in using the zebrafish to try to solve this problem. So again, we're using whole zebrafish. Zebrafish are well studied. We have a very good staging available. I decided for the first pilot experiment, which I'll describe today, to focus on the first 24 hours of zebrafish development. So I'm actually starting at about 4 hours, which is kind of when the cleavages end and when just prior to the fate maps are generally built, and going through 24 hours. Now this was this time series was chosen partly for practical reasons because it's very easy to dissociate these early embryos, but also this sort of time window encompasses some really important processes for vertebrate development. So it encompasses the fate map that has been built, germ layer formation, gastrulation, some mitogenesis, neural patterning, and up to the phylotypic stage of the embryo. So far I've collected about 35,000 cells across this time series. And I'll tell you a little bit about how far this data has been able to take us so far. And again, I'll just say, we really think that the droplet-based techniques are, they're obviously, they have their flaws, they're not perfect, but the fact that they give us access to tens of thousands of cells really opens up certain kinds of questions that were just impossible to think about addressing before. So the experimental workflow I'm using is taking the embryos, growing them to the stages that I showed you on that previous slide, dissociating to single cells, and then throwing them into the in-drops device. Now this actually, like other people have said, actually required a lot of work to make it as good as it could possibly be. So some things, and this is really every week or month that you spend making this better will pay out later on in terms of data quality. This is kind of a lesson we've all been learning in the lab. So it's really important to get at the very end of this dissociation before you start a very clean single-cell suspension. What I ended up using is the most gentle possible dissociation procedure that I could use to get this suspension. So I'm using, depending on the time point, either simply pipetting up and down very gently, and then at later time points, I'm using a dissociation enzyme. So the things I'm looking for in these protocols is cell viability by Tripan Blue or FACS above 90%, hopefully well above 90%. You want to reduce, you want to not hardly ever see cell doublets in your suspension. This is actually a more concentrated suspension than the one that actually goes in the device. So it's it looks like there's some doublets here, but when we actually do it, it's more dilute. Another thing for in-drops, I guess one drawback to both in-drops and 10x genomics, the fact that you're performing the RT reaction inside the droplet gives you certain advantages, but it also comes with a trade-off. So you have to make sure that whatever solution your cells are suspended in does not inhibit the RT reaction, and also that the cell itself does not inhibit the RT reaction. So there's a whole set of important controls that's good to do at the beginning of one of these experiments. And I think the biggest lesson that I learned when I was kind of putting this together is really speed. So initially I was using FACS to help clean up some of these single cell suspensions. And FACS is great, you can use it to filter out dead cells, you can get rid of debris, et cetera. But it was really, in my hands, adding too much time to the protocol. So in the end, what produced better data was eliminating FACS altogether, making the dissociation as fast and clean as possible, such that I can dissociate an embryo and within 20 to 30 minutes be on the device. So I think that's speed, if you're not gonna fix your cells, is probably the most important variable to look at. So we get this question a lot, and we grapple with this question a lot. How deeply should you sequence each cell? And it starts to matter even more when you're looking at tens of thousands of cells, because at some point it becomes a practical trade-off. Because you have so much money to spend, you have so much grant money. Do you spend it on sequencing more cells or sequencing a smaller number of cells more deeply? So Matt Thompson had a really interesting paper on this topic earlier this year in Cell Systems. And if you haven't read it, I would encourage you to take a look. So what he did is took a large number of published single cell data sets and bulk microarray RNA-seq data sets and simply asked, if we subsample the number of initial reads in that data, how far can we subsample and still be able to arrive at the same conclusions that the paper saw? And again, they looked at many different data sets. This is sort of a asking whether they could distinguish how many transcripts it took to distinguish similar types of neuronal cells. The take-home message was they think that just 1% of the conventional read depths is enough, sufficient usually, to distinguish cell types. So traditionally, we're used to seeing millions of reads per cell, tens of millions of reads per cell. And the claim from this paper is that that's much, much far beyond what's actually needed. So the claim then is that tens of thousands or 100,000 is more the range in which we should be operating to kind of maximize cost considerations. So when I was approaching this question, I took a very just practical approach. I probably should go back and subsample and ask like the way they did in that paper. But really what I did first of all was take one library. So we had one zebrafish library that one of the first ones I collected, which was sequenced more deeply than anything else I had looked at before, about 120,000 mapped reads per cell, so about twice that many raw reads per cell, and then subsampled. So on the x-axis, I'm showing you the number of mapped reads for the full library on the right, or the subsampled libraries. And then asking these two kind of commonly used metrics for information content per cell. So number of UMIs recovered per cell on the left, or the number of genes detected per cell on the right. So as you can see, as you sequence deeper and deeper and deeper, you start to experience diminishing returns in terms of the information that you're getting out. So compare the last two time points, or the last two points, you're basically getting maybe a 20% increase, 10 to 20% increase in information by doubling the cost of the experiment. So what we ended up targeting was about 30 to 40,000 mapped reads per cell, so about twice that many raw reads per cell, which in our hands for the zebrafish data is giving us between 8 and 10,000 UMIs and up to 4,000 genes per cell. So this is just our sort of practical approach to where we settled on this question. Now this, of course, it depends on a lot of things. It depends on how different your cells are from each other. If you're studying a cell population where the cells are all very similar to each other and you're looking for tiny differences, you might need more sequencing depth. In our case, we're looking at different tissues from a whole embryo. So the differences are quite robust and you can get away with less sequencing. I won't talk too much about this. So we have a pipeline for processing our sequencing data. Much of this is encapsulated in that GitHub page and the pipeline that we have available to people. But basically, we take the data through, after we prepare sequencing libraries, we sequence, we go through a number of trimming steps for quality, we map to this transcriptome, we do UMI filtering. Another very important step in data analysis is how you identify your variable genes, and there's also a lot of many strategies out there for how you do this. We're actually using the FANO factor, which is related to the coefficient of variation for selecting variable genes. But I won't talk too much about that today. One tool that has been developed in the lab by Virginia, who's a staff scientist, is called T-SNE Explorer. It's coded in MATLAB, and it's something we're all using to get a very rapid kind of a sense for a data set. So using T-SNE Explorer, we can explore different clusters, we can highlight different clusters, do differential expression between clusters identified by a density clustering algorithm, for example. And using T-SNE Explorer on the zebrafish data, if you just look at each time point individually, you can start to assemble a massive catalog of cell states. And as you can see, this is increasing, not surprisingly, over time. And this becomes a curation effort. So far I've manually curated these clusters, kind of looked up all the genes for all of them, tried to make sense of them. We're getting up to about 60 for the last time point, but it's actually higher than that. So there's still work to do on this. One little tidbit that was kind of fun that I actually just discovered recently is there is evidence for some new cell types, we think. So one of these is that we found amongst the epidermal cell types, and this is at later stages of the embryo, There are several populations of cells that if you look up the published expression patterns for these genes, they're in these scattered cells across the epidermis. And there's a common annotation in the ZFIN database to just call all these cells mucus cells. But we know from the single cell data that there's at least several types of these cells. So I'm excited about this to look into. It's not surprising that a cell type like this would have been hard to flag as different because there's no real anatomical restriction. They're salt and pepper scattered. So this is something we're interested in following up. So getting back to the initial goal that I talked about, how can we take all this cluster information and try to assemble some kind of tree, some kind of scaffold of development? So we're working on this. This is work, I'll say, is being championed by Caleb Weinreb, who's a grad student in the Klein Lab. So a strategy we're working with now is to assemble a scaffold, which is a series of nodes and edges, like a network graph, where each cluster is a node. So each of those clusters that I already showed you is a node in the graph. For each cluster, we try to identify the most similar cluster from the previous time point and build an edge between those clusters. And then we have one simple rule for the map that clusters can have multiple children, but only one parent. So Caleb has built a really fantastic tool, which we're still tweaking and still developing, for navigation of the trees that you can build from this kind of algorithm. So this is actually Xenopus data from a similar project we're also doing to look at Xenopus development. But the trees for zebrafish are very similar so far. So with this tool, you can go in, starting at the first time point on the left, you can see the complexity really explodes after the fourth time point. This tool lets you go in, look at genes, assemble differentiation trajectories. So you can pick a cluster, trace back the history of that cluster, and then plot, explore genes and explore trends that way. So that's one way to do it. One way is to build this scaffold out of clusters where you've already taken the data and segmented it into different groups. So what about a method where we could actually use the single cell resolution itself to sort of look at finer points, finer details of the differentiation trajectories? So one kind of it's become a workhorse of the single cell data analysis field is t-SNE. So we can use t-SNE to visualize a structure of a population. But it's important to remember that because of the way t-SNE works, a lot of the long-range distances in a t-SNE map are completely meaningless. And actually, if you run t-SNE multiple times, you get many different answers each time. So one way to overcome this is to run it multiple times and really just focus on the conserved features that you see over and over again. But if you really are just looking at a single t-SNE map and trying to interpret shapes and things, you can start to run into problems because it doesn't always mean what you, it's not always meaningful. So the approach we've taken is similar in some ways to the approach of Monocle, which is to reduce the space using a dimensionality reduction method and then construct a network graph. So as opposed to Monocle, which really tries to produce one final good answer for a trajectory, what we're trying to do is really build a tool that lets you just explore all the different possible hypotheses that might be there. So there's many ways to like rotate one of these data sets or pull on it or look at different features of it. So our philosophy is more a tool that lets you explore as much as possible. So I'll tell you a little bit about some strategies we're using with network graphs. So in the sort of two examples I'll show, we're building these network graphs. Each node is a cell. Each edge connects to highly similar cells in gene expression space. We're assembling a k nearest neighbor graph where we choose k, and this, you know, we choose it with some criteria where we connect each cell to its k nearest neighbors. And then we simulate the edge as a series of springs. And this spring simulation lets you have a really fun either method for building models or to interact with the data dynamically. So this is an example of Spring. So the tool is called Spring, and as I said, it's been developed by Caleb, who's a grad student in Alon's lab. So this is it's a human airway cell type where Spring basically lets you create this map, similar to a T-SNE map, to visualize these trajectories. And T-SNE is interactive. So in addition to being able to like rotate this and pull on it and expose different nubs or nodes that might be obscured in the third dimension, et cetera, you can also select genes, do differential expression analysis, pull up marker genes, pull up annotations, do things like that. And probably one of the most important features of Spring is that it's reproducible. So if you run Spring and T-SNE on three different samples of the same cell type, Spring gives you much more consistent population structure than T-SNE does. So Spring is, there's been a paper, it's been submitted. There's also a GitHub for it where you can download and play with it yourself. Eventually it will be a web server-based interface that we hope to use to communicate our own results. But at this point, I think anybody can download and use it themselves. And again, some of the features of it are it's very user-friendly, it's web-based, so you interact with it via a web browser. So it's very simple to use. Now, one of the things that Spring can't really do at the moment is handle multiple time points. So time points introduce a complication to trajectory reconstruction. And that's how do you assemble a single... How much, 5 minutes? Okay, I'm almost there. How do you assemble a graph where you have multiple time points and global changes that distinguish each time point from another? So time points actually behave somewhat like batch effects when you try to put them all together. So the strategy we're using is to assemble a local KNN graph for each time point and each pair of adjacent time points. The nice thing about assembling the KNN graph is you can use gene expression information to do that initial construction, and then you can omit the gene expression information entirely. So once you've assembled the first part, you can forget about the genes that you used, and then assemble the bridge, and then assemble time point two and time point three. So after stitching this all together, excluding non-mutual edges, and we can use a similar force-directed layout to look at the graph. So this is actually what happens if I apply that approach to the zebrafish data. So this is all seven time points. This is about 32,000 cells together. And you can see it collapses the data and forms something kind of looking like a tree. If we go back in and look at time points, you can see that the tree that came out of this analysis has the early time points at the very center and sort of fanning and radiating out. As time goes forward into several different branches. And then I can kind of fly through this a little bit, but we can start to explore this tree using very well-established marker genes for mesoderm, epiderm, the different germ layers, and really convince ourselves that these branches do correspond to sort of sound predictions of germ layers and lineage segregation. Like I said, we're still at the very beginning of this. We're still developing a lot of these tools and developing the logic that we need to kind of navigate these data sets. So some of the things we're most excited about are finding new cell types using the cluster browser and following up with in situs and other in vivo experiments. We're also starting to find some really interesting topological features of the tree. So some things I'll just hint at now is we're really interested in independent acquisition of common transcriptional modules. So for example, some of the placodes that are epidermally derived eventually generate neurons or sensory perceptive fields. And being able to look at how an epidermal tissue acquires transcriptional modules that are normally characteristic of another germ layer is interesting. These maps will allow us to look at flux speeds of differentiation and also flow between germ layers. So one really interesting point, we found that red arrow is pointing to a region of high density between the mesoderm and the neurectoderm, which we think corresponds to the tail bud. So we're really interested in looking at flow between those sort of germ layer branches. And that's pretty much all I have. So I want to thank Alon for all of his support and his advice, and all the members of the lab and the collaborators that we've worked with in the past. So that's it. I'll take questions. No, so there's many ways to do this. So we've used a local density based clustering algorithm, which is not like K means. You're basically agnostic to the number of clusters, and so it's looking for regions of focused density and calling that a cluster. It's based on DB scan, yeah.
Because also that, you can change the parameter, you totally change the number of clusters.
Yeah.
Yeah,
so I didn't actually code it, but Virginia in our lab coded a DBScan algorithm that surveys the whole map and then looks for, it can locally tune those parameters in different regions of the map because some parts are more dense, some parts are less dense. One set of parameters doesn't necessarily work for the whole map. So it's an automated way of learning what the local parameters should be and then just using that. Yeah, we're still at the beginning. So definitely we want to use it to discover new genes. So that's a big part of it. Also, we have ways, so I'm also a joint postdoc in the Megason lab. So we have a very sophisticated live imaging capability in that lab for doing looking at lineage relationships, things like that. So that's one way. And then there's other ways to validate claims about lineage relationships. So I'm looking at all those options for validating a particular topology that we might see in the tree. Yeah. Okay. Thanks.
I think we are running.
We're late.
But can you start exactly?